As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind. So that God's works might be revealed in him, we must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it's someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "How then were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Well, where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees began to ask how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "The man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He was a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and he had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son. We know he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for a second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Well, it is now Tuesday evening. You have enjoyed with God a powerful and profound day of prayer. You began the day with a "Here I am" prayer before you even got out of bed, focusing and centering your thoughts on who God wants you to be in that day. You've taken the time during your turnpike commute, you've turned off the radio, and you've taken those moments to meditate upon the words of your favorite hymn, "Amazing Grace." You've stopped for a moment during your time at work and you've done a Lectio Divina, a holy reading of your vocational place, your workplace. It has changed your heart. Instead of a feeling as though you're out of place, instead of feeling as though you're intimidated or even afraid, you have felt more at peace and more at home, knowing that God is in this place. And now it's Tuesday evening. You're headed to meet some friends downtown on Massachusetts Street. You find a perfect parking place just a few feet away from the restaurant, and you get out knowing you're living a charmed life, and then you see him. Right there by Signs of Life, by the pedestrian walkway with the mural, he's sitting on the ground holding a cardboard sign that somebody has made for him. Born blind. Any money helps. God bless. Well, thanks, God. What am I going to do about this? How am I supposed to respond to this? We've had this beautiful, wonderful day of prayer. Well, I've heard you, I've listened to you, I've seen you. But now what do I do? What am I supposed to do in a situation like this? How am I supposed to pray in a situation like this? The man sat by the side of the road, day in and day out, waiting to receive something. He was blind, and so he just waited in the darkness, listening for somebody to stop. Occasionally somebody would and drop something in his cup. Most would just scurry on past. Until he heard a person stop very close to him. He could tell he leaned over and squatted next to him because he could hear his breathing very close. He heard him spit in the ground and do something with the mud on the ground. And then he felt the earth on his face. He heard a whisper in his ear, "Go to the pool of healing and your sight will be restored." And so he did. And it was. And everybody else completely lost their minds. Nobody knew what to do with this moment of healing that Jesus performed. We read the story in which the man received his sight after going to the pool of Siloam. And everybody else in the story, they just go nuts. They don't know what to do with this. There's four examples of four different groups of folks that respond to this event. And I would say what ties them together is each of them struggle to reconcile the reality of what they have seen with their own theology. The first group is the disciples. As they're walking down the road, they see the man blind on the side of the road and say, "Well, say, so Jesus, So did this man sin or did his parents sin so that he is blind? Because those are the only two options." See, theirs was a theology of morality that they placed upon this man. He's a failure, a moral failure. He is a sinner, or somebody is a sinner. It's this idea that goes way back, that suffering is caused by our own choices, which means very clearly, just like back in the days of Job and his friends, that if this man is suffering, it's somebody's fault. They blame out of this theology of morality. And the reality is, how many of us can say that we're that different? When we see the man on Mass Street with a sign, how many of us say, "Well, is this guy just too lazy to get a job? Or maybe somebody didn't take care of him when they should have?" Because those are the only two options. Our theology of morality says, "Sinner!" And how quick we are to blame the victim. The next group that responds to this event are the townspeople. The townspeople kind of crack me up because they've seen this man sitting by the side of the road for ages, but then they can't figure out, is this the same guy? I don't think it's the same guy. It looks kind of the same, but it's got to be somebody different. Is that him? I think it's him. Meanwhile, the guy's sitting there the whole time, "I'm the man. I'm the one. It was me." And they I think, fall into this trap of the theology of apathy. They didn't even pay attention to the man that they walked by day in and day out. How many times a day? They didn't even look at his face to know whether it was the same guy or not. And how many of us relate? How many of us, when we see the guy on Mass, just try to get by as quick as we can? Avoid eye contact, avoid conversation, avoid the entire encounter, if at all possible. You know, maybe our theology of apathy sounds something like this. We say, "Well, I think in the Bible somewhere Jesus said that, well, you'll always have the poor with you, so that means I don't have to worry about him." Of course, we cherry pick the Bible, do we not? For about 10 verses earlier, Jesus actually said, "If you don't care for the least of these, you're not caring for me, and punishment will be the result." He made it pretty clear. Apathy is not an option. The third group is the Pharisees. We love to pick on the Pharisees, but in this case, they kind of deserve it. So the the reality is that they saw this man, they saw him healed, they saw that it happened on the Sabbath, and when they heard the story, here was their problem. When Jesus spat on the ground and made the clay, he needed the clay, which was work, which you couldn't do on the Sabbath. So if he healed the man, it must be because he had a demon, right? Seems logical to us, doesn't it? I mean, the Pharisees have this theology of piety. If you don't do it exactly the right way, then you're doing it wrong. You're a sinner. You've failed. This theology of making sure that you have to say the right words. You have to do the right words. I think it's something that we struggle with as well, do we not? How many, I won't ask for a raising of hands, but how many, answer to yourself, are guilty of using the phrase, well, you're in my thoughts and prayers. Now, thoughts and prayers are a good thing, but how often when we say those words do we mean, you're in my thoughts and prayers so that I don't have to really do anything? I don't have to help you. I don't have to act. I don't have to advocate for you. I don't have to really work. You're in my thoughts and prayers, and to be honest, I'm probably going to forget about that even. Ours is the theology of piety, pretending as though we are holier than thou. And finally, the last group is the man's parents themselves. Now, this is an interesting case. You'd think that they would be just ecstatic that this man has been healed, but they're not. They're terrified. I think it's because they come out of a theology of authority. Now, it says that they were afraid when the Pharisees came and spoke to them. Specifically, it says they were afraid of the Jews. Now, you have to understand what John means here, because these people, the parents were Jews, and the man was a Jew, and Jesus was a Jew, and the Pharisees were Jew. Everybody in the story was a Jew. So it seems a little strange to say, well, he was afraid of the Jews. They were afraid specifically of the Jewish authority. The preachers, the religious executives, the people that were in charge. That's who they were afraid of, because they thought if they got caught up with Jesus, who was already making enemies with these Pharisees, with these authorities, then they would be caught up in it and be kicked out of the synagogue as well. They were afraid of the authority that rested over them. And how often do we do the same thing? We look at authority and we try to blame up the ladder. We see the guy on Mass Street and say, well, what's the city doing about these people? What's the county doing? Shouldn't they be taking care of people like this so that I don't have to see them on my way to my restaurant? The fallacy of authority is strong. So we hear these examples of these people that just don't get it. We see this a lot in John. People just don't get it. And how often do we feel like we fit? It feels like it's a story of bad news, but it's not. It's not. It is a story of gospel. It is the story of good news. The point of this is that Jesus has come to bring good news to the people. And so the argument that I would make is when Jesus says that the reality of suffering on earth does not reconcile with your theology, Jesus says it's time for a new theology. It's time to look again. Jesus says it's time for new eyes. This story is a powerful one because it talks about the difference between sightedness and blindness. Again, it's this duality that continues throughout really the whole story. It's the man who was blind who then receives his sight, and the Pharisees who think that they have sight, and Jesus says, no, you're actually blind. You're missing everything. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. I bring light. I can illumine those who are in need. And so this difference between sightedness and blindness is a significant one in the story. And so what Jesus is saying here in John is that you're getting it all wrong. The disciples who say, well, who sinned? Was it this man or his parents? Jesus says, no. Wrong question. The question is not about this man's individual morality. The question is about the reality of all of human suffering. God has created the world, and we have all participated in the twisting, the corrupting of it. Our sin is the way that we participate in the brokenness of this world. But there is good news. There is something new to see, says Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, Jesus says in John. There is good news here. In John, we read that Jesus is all about the hope of salvation being not a theology of apathy, not a theology of authority, not a theology of piety, not a theology of morality, but one of transformation. That God is reaching into the world to transform the world. Salvation comes in the transformation, most specifically in the person of Christ, but even in our own incarnational reality. And so there is good news for those who will open their eyes to see. And then the second piece, not only will we open our eyes to see, but we open our ears to hear. So this story, the section I read is actually just a beginning part of a long, long, longer section that goes all the way through like the middle of chapter 10. And so Jesus has this healing event, and then there's all these conversations that take place, and then Jesus just preaches a sermon. He just has this discourse where he starts talking to the man who is healed and then just kind of just preaches this sermon. And here are some of the words from this sermon, words that you might recognize. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls out his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used his figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they might have life and have it abundantly." Jesus says, he who has ears like sheep. He says, you all know about sheep. Sheep don't just go follow anybody. They know the voice of the shepherd. Jesus says, I'm the shepherd. I'm the good shepherd, and I'm inviting you to hear me. Jesus says, we must have new eyes to see. We must have new ears to hear. So what does it say to us? What does it say when we see the guy on Mass? What does it say when we live a life of prayer and we're trying our best, and now what do we do in this moment? Well, I believe the truth is the same for us today, that we must have new eyes to see and we must have new ears to hear. Of course, first off, we need to see in a new way. We need to see with this idea, see the world around us in more compassionate way. I love the hymn that the choir sang, the compassion hymn, to help open our eyes to new ways of seeing. Frank Laubach talks about this. He says, prayer opens our eyes to new ways of seeing. He talks about this metaphor of windows. He says that he has struggled with the windows that only open up. When he prays, it's kind of me and Jesus. I'm talking to God. I listen to God. That's what prayer is all about. He said, hey, that can't be the end of prayer. Prayer also has to have windows that open outward to see the whole world. And then he says, not only upward, not only outward, but windows that open downward to see those who are most deeply in need. That's what prayer is about. Prayer opens our eyes upward and outward and downward for all so that we can see with new eyes. Not only that, we have to hear with new ears. Prayer helps us to hear with new ears. There's a way to talk about prayer, the Franciscan model. Now, many of you might know St. Francis of Assisi. He actually lived seven centuries prior to Frank Laubach, and he also talked about prayer, and he lived a life of prayer. He lived in a deep, meaningful way of praying. But he didn't like to pray in church. He didn't like to pray in very intentional, structured, formal ways. He liked to pray just kind of everywhere. Chester Michael and Marie Norrissey suggest that we can pray, too, with the Franciscan model. They say two or three things that need to be done. First, don't limit your prayers. Don't limit your prayers for prayer that happens in church, prayer that happens in intentional, kind of formal, structured ways. Just pray as you go. Pray as you see things around you. This is the Franciscan model. This is what St. Francis did. He prayed as he went. Second thing that they say to do is what I call arrow prayers. Kind of like you shoot an arrow up in the air. It's kind of how we can pray to God. If you smell the beautiful spring flowers, you say, thanks, God. Shoot an arrow of gratitude. Or maybe you hear the fire engine or the ambulance a few blocks away. Say a prayer for the victim there. Maybe for the first responders. Shoot an arrow. Maybe you see somebody, like somebody on the side of the road. Somebody who is in need. Somebody with a sign. Can you shoot a prayer? An arrow to say, God, be with them today. But then there's that third piece. So don't limit your prayer. Pray arrow prayers. But then be ready to respond. I also talk about St. Francis. He didn't just go around and say, well, you're in my thoughts and prayers. He was ready to respond in a moment's notice, to listen to the Spirit and what the Spirit had to say and do what needed to be done in that moment. Francis did all kinds of crazy stuff because he was willing to hear and to obey. He actually followed in the example of somebody who came 7 centuries before him, St. Benedict, who wrote about this idea of prayer in Latin, ora et labora, prayer and work. He said the two have to be fused, two sides of the same coin. We cannot pray without work, and we cannot work without prayer. The two have to come together, said Benedict. We have to understand that both of these things need to happen. And so when we are ready to go out into the world, when we're ready to pray as we go, to do a Franciscan prayer in our lives, we have to also be ready to labora, to work, to do what needs to be done, to respond to the calling of the Holy Spirit. Now, I don't know what that looks like. I don't know what that looks like on Tuesday evening when you see the guy in the sign. I don't know. I appreciate Shane's struggle because it is a struggle. It's a complicated, it's a difficult question to ask, but here's my hope. My hope is that we come with a sense of ora and labora, prayer and labor, work to do what needs to be done. Maybe it means that you buy the guy a meal. Maybe it means that you sit down and talk to him, make sure he knows about the shelter, he has a place to sleep for the evening. Maybe you say, I think this shows how much we need the shelter, and you give a financial gift. Maybe you help Willow, domestic violence shelter. Maybe you give something to Link so that folks who are in need can have somewhere to go to eat. Maybe you volunteer with Wendy Wheeler to just do a casserole every other month, right? Maybe you listen to the prompting of the Spirit to do, to labora something. Maybe you choose to advocate. Maybe you choose to join the work of Justice Matters that says we're going to work to bring affordable housing to our community so that people don't need to be so hardly destitute. I don't know what the prompting would look like in your life. I don't know, but I know that the Spirit will prompt, and we're invited to respond. I had lunch last week with Dave Nordland. Most of you will know Dave. Some of you might not. Dave is a decades-long member of our congregation, and he has done incredible work here in this church. Actually, I think he's a great example of ora et labora. He's a man of deep and profound faith, a man of deep and profound prayer about God, to God, and he's also a man of hard work. I mean, he ran that sound booth for decades, and filled the baptistry every time we needed to. He did work all around the church. Last couple years, he's been able to finally retire from some of that, but he continues his life of ora et labora in different ways. I asked his permission to share this story with him. He said, absolutely. You know, as we sat and shared lunch together, he told me some about his ways he sees God, kind of the visions that God gives to him. And one of the visions, one of the methods that he sees God is by seeing the hand of God. God's hand reaching out to him, giving him grace, giving him love, giving him peace. And I told him I got cold chills because all I could think of was the story of the blind man who could see nothing, had no idea who was standing by him, and had to simply wait for the hand of the healer to be placed upon his face and in that moment forever be changed. May we see God as Dave sees God. May we see God and experience God as the blind man experienced the healing touch of the Savior. May we know. May our prayers open our eyes in new ways. May they open our ears in new ways. May we experience the very touch of God's hand in our lives and in our hearts. Let's pray. God, you who are above and beyond, reaching into our lives, transforming our lives, give us new eyes, give us new ears, give us a new heart. In your name we pray. Amen.